Hi, my name's Joel, and I'm a 90s kid. And I recently discovered that before my fantastic generation graced this planet, that there were actually many, many generations before us creating really great music. Jokes aside, today I'm so excited to be starting a brand new series where I'm gonna be going back and listening to the greatest music from every decade over the last 100 years. And as I go, rather than try to rate them or put them on a tier list and evaluate them, what I'm gonna do is give them a simple pass-fail rating of whether we should acclaim these songs for their greatness or we should just forget them. As you already know from the title, first on the chopping block is the 1930s. So let's go back to the Great Depression, the Hoover Dam, the start of World War II. I'm really glad I didn't live in the 30s. But let's hear what music was great. Kicking things off for us at number 10 from the year of 1939 is All the Things You Are by Tommy Dorsey and Jack Leonard. The song was written by Jerome Kern with lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein II for the musical Very Warm in May, a musical I've never heard of. When I was making this list, I kept encountering Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey, and I had never heard of them, but it seems like they made a huge impact on music. Probably people who know a lot more than me are gonna be like, yeah, they're really important. But it looks like they make great contributions, like not only to musicals, but also to like jazz standards, and were a really big deal from the 30s all the way through the 50s, where they both died relatively young for kind of weird causes. But anyways, enough preamble, let's listen to the song. This makes me kind of sad feeling. Ooh, ooh, you hear that? Ooh, okay. Okay, Tommy, okay, Tommy. Trembles on the brink of a lovely song. Man, you don't really get a lot of male vocalists in this range anymore. It's just, it's a very like high tenor kind of world these days. The dearest things I know ooh. Are what you are. The deepest pain I know is all you are. The dearest things I know are what you are, okay. I kind of hate that, like, classic. It really, to me, it's probably just how it's aged, comes off as, like, super cheesy. So that's my first time hearing this song, and my initial impression is it kind of fits in my box of what I imagine 30s and 40s music kind of sounding like. It's very stereotypical to me of, like, if I'm watching, like, a World War II movie and someone puts something on a record player, I'm like, yeah, that's what that sounds like. Maybe that's not fair, and it's also possible that because this is such a popular song, like maybe I've encountered it or things of this style in other media like this. But for me, this isn't the most inspiring kind of music. I think the instrumentation's pretty cool, and I like that it's very relaxed. The song never like tries to go crazy, I feel like. And I also really appreciate that a lot of different instruments get a pass around a melody as it goes along, but overall, it's not my favorite thing. I didn't really care for the singing part a whole lot, and the lyrics on it, not my thing. In no way do I think this is a bad song, but for me, I'm comfortable starting this off with a forget it.
What?
In our number 9 slot, we have A Tisket, A Tasket by Ella Fitzgerald with the Chick Webb Orchestra. Unlike the Dorseys, Ella Fitzgerald is absolutely someone I've heard of. I have a little trouble placing the songs, but I'm pretty sure she has a version of Cheek to Cheek that I've heard. And she has some Christmas music, right? Just hear those yeah. I feel like this is the only version of Sleigh Ride I've ever heard. I'm sure there are other versions like every Christmas song, but this is like the one. Anyhow, A Tisket, A Tasket, I've never heard, but apparently it's based on a children's rhyme that goes A Tisket or Tasket, a green and yellow basket, which where I'm from is called Ring Around the Rosy. Ring around the rosy, a pocket full of posy, ashes, ashes, they all fell down. But apparently, in some places, they say, a tisket, a tasket, a green and yellow basket. I wrote a letter to my friend, and on the way, I dropped it. I dropped it, I dropped it, and on the way, I dropped it. We get it. You dropped it. A little boy, he picked it up and put it in his pocket. So they did say dropped it 4 times in 3 lines. Anyhow, whether you call it A Tisket, A Tasket, or A Ring Around the Rosy, this is also the same melody as It's Raining, It's Pouring, The Old Man Is Snoring. But let's listen to the song. I send a letter to my mommy, on the way I dropped it. Oh man, I love how she sings that. And put it in a pocket. I'm glad that in the 30s, we already had music videos with really insincere, unhappy extras. Like, these people on her left and her right are just like, I'm glad to be here. Oh. I didn't see that coming. That's so fun. That dude has a tiny guitar. That's not even like a 3/4. That looks so small. No, no. That's such a good laugh. Honestly, this is such a simple music video. I feel like artists now need to take a cue. This is so good. I think this is the no-no knows. Mom, go outside. Do some chores. Do your homework. Man, I didn't expect this to be so captivating, especially when I read it was based on like a nursery rhyme. I'm gonna say we acclaim it. This isn't like the greatest music I've heard in my whole life. But on the flip side, that was so fun. She's such a good performer and her voice is amazing. Man, maybe I've been sleeping on Ella Fitzgerald apparently. Dang, that's good stuff. Coming in hot at number 8 from 1936, it is Mr. Christmas himself, Bing Crosby. Also featuring George Stoll, who I don't know. This song is called Pennies from Heaven, and it's written by Arthur Johnson with lyrics by Johnny Burke. And again, I've never heard it. Oh my gosh, is this what Bing Crosby looked like? He's like a young Grand Moff Tarkin. A million years BC. I'm sure it's probably because my only real exposure to Bing Crosby is through Christmas music. That's the only thing I've heard. So his voice to me is Christmas. And this started out, a lot of Christmas music is this like older jazz style because that's the era. So like this started and I was like, it's a Christmas song. I don't think this is a Christmas song, but in my brain, that is what this voice and this style of music means, Christmas. Is upside down. Oh, that's good. Be sure your umbrella's upside down to catch the pennies from heaven. That was awesome. This is the first one, at least up till now, that I really love the songwriting. Like, these lyrics are great. Like, introduce, like, everything was free and, like, we appreciated things a long time ago when the world was simpler, which is kind of funny to hear from, like, you know, the 30s and 40s, you know, a time when, like, people now consider life was much simpler. But yeah, just in the first listen, it seems like he's talking about, hey, sometimes you go through bad things or you lose good things so that you can appreciate the great things more when they come back. And also that storm clouds come and bad things happen in life, but you know, you can get the good things out of that. And there's a silver lining. It's just some really good songwriting. I love the lyrics and I love the rhyming pattern on this last line. It goes, so when you hear it thunder, don't run under a tree. Okay, Pennies from Heaven is my favorite so far. Absolutely acclaim it. For our number 7th most popular song of the 30s, we have The Way You Look Tonight by Fred Astaire and Johnny Green. This song was written for the movie Swing Time, and it's by Jerome Kern and lyrics by Dorothy Fields. This is actually our second appearance of Mr. Jerome Kern on this list, because he also showed up for our number 10, All the Things You Are composer. I'm assuming we'll see a lot of that, just like in today's world, we get a lot of music producers that are showing up on tons of different artists. Probably be about the same here, right? I have heard some Fred Astaire before, but I have never heard this song. So, let's give it a listen. Oh, Johnny Green and his orchestra. So Johnny Green ain't singing on this.
Before I go, I just want to tell you that maybe I was wrong the other night.
Oh.
But I didn't know it at the time.
So now you know.
Yes, I do. Oh, no. This one is on me.
Maybe I should watch this movie. Ooh. I like that. I like this string. Na-dun. Na-dun. Nice. With each word. Oh! Spicy. That was a nice key change. Okay, Freddy. Oh no. Tonight. He's gonna scream. Oh my. Okay, I know I was super hyped about the key change, but honestly, this song doesn't deeply connect with me. I feel like this is like a replaceable love song in any musical. I'm not saying it's bad. It just doesn't really speak to me a whole lot. The style's fine. The song's fine. The lyrics, I think the lyrics are fine. But I'm here just to find the greatest music. And this song's good, but is it the greatest? I don't think so. So I'm going to say The Way You Look Tonight can be forgotten.
Hey, what?
Forget it.
Begin.
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 Begin. Begin. Begin. Begin. I mean. Number 6, we have Begin the Begin from 1938 by Artie Shaw. This song was written by Cole Porter for the Broadway musical Jubilee, which I've also never heard of. I actually haven't heard of a single one of these musicals or movies so far, so I don't know if that says something about the musicals and how long they've lasted, or it says something about me and how much of a shut-in I am. Either way, these are nearly 100 years old, and I think we should just appreciate the fact that we're like one of the first generations that could listen to music 100 years ago. This is a very recent phenomenon that we've had recordings of music that long ago. Oh. I might actually know this. But why would I have heard this?
First successful recording was the swing orchestra version by Artie Shaw in 1938. 1981, Julio Iglesias released a Spanish version, which is number one in the UK.
I mean, it sounds like this is a wildly popular song and remains so, especially with the Julio Iglesias version. So, I don't know. Maybe I've just heard it around somewhere. Ooh. I don't know that this guitarist is doing anything. Look at this guy on the left. I don't know. Definitely don't think there's any guitar in this recording. And if there is, it is really quiet. But I don't think it's what this dude's playing. Ooh. Let's go. I'm judging the song, not the videos. But while I'm here, let me be critical and say, this dude, a lot better performer than the guy playing clarinet at the beginning. He was so boring. He had no performance in him. It was just... This one is a little tough because I feel like it's... like a somewhat advanced piece of music. It's got some cool ideas in it, but like if this is me speaking from me, would I go listen to this? Like, I think if I saw it live, I would be engaged and I would enjoy like seeing someone perform this live, but I don't really want to hear this song more. I don't know. It was fun. It was fine as a listen, but I don't know. Overall, it's probably like a cool piece of repertoire, and I'm coming at this from like a non-jazz perspective, which is probably not going to be good for the 30s and 40s, in all honesty. But for me, this is not like a great listening song. It might be a great jamming song or like a great piece of repertoire to have. But for me, as like something I'm going to pop on a playlist, I'm going to say, forget it.
Wait, what?
We are rolling in at halfway through the 1930s. And I just wanted to pause and let you know that down in the description, I'm going to be leaving a link to a Spotify playlist. And that playlist is going to have all of the acclaim songs for this whole series from the 1930s all the way through the 2020s. So 100 years of music, the best songs of all the top 10s, I'll be leaving right there. So be sure to check that out and give it a listen. Okay, back to the video. Let's get back into it at number 5, Stormy Weather, Keeps Raining All the Time by Ethel Waters in 1933. This song was written by Harold Arlen and Ted Kohler, but the band was the Dorsey Brothers. Tommy and Jimmy are literally everywhere. They are just the legends I never knew I needed and never knew I had the whole time. And once again, this is my first time hearing this song, to the best of my knowledge.
When he went away, the blues walked in and met me.
Oh, whoa. Whoa. That was weird. That was weird. Did the timing change? That felt like we sped up. Oh.
Love, love.
Dang. That's powerful. Love. Oh. Man, her voice is cool. I've never heard Ethel Waters before. This is first time for me as far as I know. And dang. This is tough for me. I like it a lot. But am I going to like it in 2 weeks? I think it really captivated me. And her performance is really, really good. But... do I like the song that much? I think I'm going to give it to it. Stormy Weathers. This is a cool song. I like the lyrics. And when the tempo stuff's really cool. I feel like the music doesn't like... it's really just vocal, right? It's like all vocal. And that's cool. I think I'm into it, though. Acclaim it. Acclaim it. Acclaim it. Let's call on our boy Fred Astaire once again with the 1935 song. I've already heard it. It is called Cheek to Cheek. I'm pretty sure the version of this song that I'm familiar with is Fred Astaire, but I think I saw there was a Sinatra version. And to be honest with you, it's been enough time since I've heard it. I don't know if it was Sinatra or Fred Astaire. Cheek to Cheek was written by Irving Berlin for the movie Top Hat, which, funny enough, also featured Ginger Rogers, which we saw earlier in the video for The Way You Look Tonight in Swing Time. So Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, maybe they're meant to be. Or they're just actors and singers. Complete tangent here, but I feel like that happened a lot more in old movies where like you'd get the same romantic duo of actors for multiple films, but nowadays, I feel like that doesn't really happen. Like, if people are known for, like, being a great couple in one movie, they don't then show up in another one. But that might just be a feeling and not reality.
And I seem to find the happiness I see.
Dude, I think I'm falling in love with Fred Astaire.
I want my arm about you.
Okay, I know this is really simple, but I'm a huge sucker lyrically for when a song ends one section on a word and then uses that word differently in the next section, but they just share it. So it rolls right in. Oh my gosh, if he just like threw her off the stage and then Duel of the Fates started playing. This movie would go like so far up in my book. That would be crazy. It just reminds me of the platforms in Phantom Menace. And this is so much choreography to memorize. It's just a long, one long cut. I know people perform dances on stage too, but man. Dude, when the strings play that, it sounds so like sultry. Like, heaven, I'm in heaven. Even more so than his voice. Man, Cheek to Cheek is definitely one of those songs that's like an earworm. I can't count the number of times that like I'm just chilling and I'm thinking, heaven, I'm in heaven. This song is just hard not to include on any great list. Like, it's got good lyrics. It's got a really cute section at the beginning. Obviously, Fred Astaire is like awesome singing. And then it goes to this whole instrumental. It's got cool percussion. And then this even has like the tap dancing in the movie. The only thing I think I don't like about the song is that I probably hear the heaven, I'm in heaven, that little motif musically, like more times than I care to by the end, but that's not enough to like exclude this song. This is clearly acclaim it. This is a great, great classic. Go listen to it. Number three, I have heard before. I'm gonna spoil this for you. Unless something dramatically changes when I hear the original recording, I will be happy to forget this song. I don't like it. I don't like it. I've heard it. I've heard it many times. I don't like it. I'm not even sure I have like a logical reason to justify it other than this puts me off. Maybe a large part of that is I've heard this perform badly multiple times. All right, enough teasing, enough leading you on. Number three is the 1939 jazz standard Glenn Miller Orchestra In the Mood. Look, I'm just spitting my preferences at you here, but I don't like this piece. It does not excite me. I don't really like big band music at all. And I try really hard never to like throw a genre out so broadly, but I'm truly open to having my mind changed. Like, I would love to hear some big band music that excited me and inspired me. To me, I would describe this whole genre as tedious. Legitimately, one of the reasons I hate Graduation so much, and I don't know if this is an American thing or not, but I hate hearing Pomp and Circumstance arranged for big band. Pomp and Circumstance is awful and sad, and we should just stop playing that garbage. I've covered off a little strong here, but I really don't like this music. Yeah, I get it. Okay, that was cool. I'll give him that. It was cool. There, I said something positive. Oh, it's still going.
1 eternity later.
What was the idea with the whistle there? I didn't like it at all. Man, I'm slouched so far. In the Mood should be acclaimed as one of the greatest accomplishments in all of music because it is incredible to have written something with so many instruments and just so much energy and still be so boring. I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. Okay, I'm fighting a losing battle attacking a jazz standard that probably is beloved. Let's just look at the comments. Does anyone agree with me? Please let there be one.
Muy acertadas las elecciones musicales.
The king of jazz swing. The king of jazz snooze. Obviously not the original studio recording. Look, it said it was. Hold on, let's go to the more popular video. Blah, 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 blah. The trumpeters in the band, Ray Anthony, is still alive today at 102.
Wow. I'm 36, and there is something about big bands, jazz, and oldies music. You could be having the worst day, hear this kind of music, and forget everything. It has a way of immediately making you feel better, puts a smile on your face, and transports you to another place in time where everything is right. May I suggest an amendment? I'm 27, and there is something about big band, jazz, and oldies music. You can be having the best day. Hear this kind of music and forget all your happiness. It has a way of just immediately making you feel worse, putting a frown on your face and transporting you to another dimension where hell has broken loose and there's only misery.
This video was going well, but I had a full breakdown, dude. I had a full breakdown on the song.
Number two, from 1932, we have Night and Day by Fred Astaire and Leo Reisman. This song has our second appearance on this list from Cole Porter, and it was written for the musical Gay Divorce, which I've never heard of. But if there's one thing I can trust about the 30s when it comes to Fred Astaire, it is that he will be with Ginger Rogers. They are just the shining duo of the 30s. I feel like this is something that anyone who is already in on this era of film and music already knows, but for me, I'm like, it's them again. It's them again. They were great the last time. They were great this time. But another crazy fact about this song is apparently, source below, after just 3 months of being out, this musical being out, 30 artists had already recorded and released their own versions. I feel like this is equivalent to when Let It Go came out and every YouTube channel did a cover of it. This is clearly a massive hit, but I have never heard it, so let's give it a listen. All right, these two haven't let me down so far.
Like the beep, beep, beat of the tom-tom when the jungle shadows fall.
Wait. What did he just say? Like the beep, beat of the tom-tom when the jungle shadow fall.
That is longing for you follows wherever I go.
Oh, man. I like that the lyrics of this song have, like, a lot of extra syllables that he gets to kind of talk through. It makes it, like, pretty casual, but nice. I like it.
Night and day.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Fred. This is how you get canceled. We saw what happened. We saw what happened with Baby It's Cold Outside. Freddie, you can't be doing this. When the woman wants to leave, let her go. Three films deep and we're coming to this. Okay. Okay, Fred. Okay, I'm just going to throw this out there. I'm most of the way through this song, but more so than Cheek to Cheek, I feel like if I wasn't watching the dancing, I'd be really bored right now. It's fine. I just feel like the music is kind of doing like the same to like, all right, now we're down and wandering. Now we're big with that main melody. Okay, now we're down and wandering. It's just kind of, I feel like I'm stuck. Oh, nice. Nice, nice. Yeah. I got bored before the singing stopped, and then the music afterwards wasn't really inspiring. I'm kind of shocked that that is much higher on the list than like Cheek to Cheek, because in my opinion, in my perspective, Cheek to Cheek has persisted far beyond. So I kind of wonder if this movie, The Gay Divorce, was a much more popular musical and movie than whatever Cheek to Cheek was from Top Hat. Or maybe I'm just missing something and have uneducated taste, but it just didn't speak to me that much. So I'm going to say Night and Day. Forget about it. Number one is a song that I have heard before, and I would guess everyone watching this video probably has heard before. It is from the 1939 musical The Wizard of Oz. It is Over the Rainbow, or Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Over the Rainbow was performed for the movie by Judy Garland, and it's written by Harold Arlen, who also wrote Stormy Weather from earlier, and it has lyrics by Yip Harburg. Yip Harburg? Yip Harburg. What a name.
Yip, yip.
Yip, yip! This is such a pleasant number one. I don't even have to listen to this to, like, I get it. This song has not aged a day. I mean, I'm sure the recording will have aged more than a day, but it's amazing. Let's hear it.
Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high.
Let's continue with a good singer. Okay, I saw this video from Shea Frillis a while back. It was like, Hero, I Want Songs. All right, top 20, I want songs in musicals. Hold on, context. It's like the song at the start of a movie or musical where the hero, like, wants their life to change, it would be different, like in Somewhere Over the Rainbow, is, it's not on here. Okay, I feel like I should watch the video again. There, I left a comment. Now Shea Frillis will love me and be my friend. Okay, thanks. Over the Rainbow is actually a difficult song to discuss because it's too good. And I feel like a lot of what could be said about it's been said. This is probably one of the most famous songs ever recorded. I think most people know this song and have heard it. It's very cool, and it's also my go-to like interval to think of when I think of an octave. The performance here is absolutely wonderful. It's actually a little more of a mature voice than I thought. In my head, I thought it was like a younger sounding voice. Apparently she was only 16, but the style she's saying makes it sound so mature. Man, what am I doing? I'm just listening to people that were good, and I'm so old. I'm not going to play a lot of this, but if you somehow haven't heard it, please go listen to the Israel... I shouldn't try this name. I'm going to try it. Kamaka Wiwo Ole. Izzy. It has more than 20 times the views on the original song's video, so it's probably very likely that you've already heard this. It's beautiful. Over the Rainbow is incredible. Let's add it to our acclaimed music from the 1930s. And it's been added to the playlist, so make sure you check that out in the description. And speaking of Spotify or Amazon or Apple Music, while you're over there, there's this artist named Joel Apsher. That's me. And I've got a new song dropping on December 6th. It's called My Little Catherine, and it's a fun beach vibe with like ukulele, marimba. It's a little love song. I'm super excited to share it with all of you, so go ahead and follow me over there so you don't miss out when that comes out. Thank you so much for watching this video. I'm super excited for the rest of this series, and let me know your favorite songs of the 30s down below. Bye. No, it's fine. I just, you know how I feel about big band, right? And there's this big band song that I think everyone will love. I literally think everyone will love it, but you know how I feel about big band. And I was like, maybe I'll give it a listen, you know, for the video, maybe I'll enjoy it. And I didn't enjoy it all. I hated all of it. Like it's not that it's like completely uninspired and crap. It's just such a snooze fest. And this is like most famous song in the 30s. And like, I don't know, man. It's not that I don't like the music, like from like a subjective, like this is how I feel about it point of view. It's that it's objectively trash.